attention, please. Welcome to Sanders Theater. Please turn off all cell phones and other electronic devices. The use of cameras and recording equipment is prohibited. Please take a moment to identify the nearest exit. In addition to the 6 regular exits, there are 2 emergency exits located at the back of the mezzanine and balcony levels. Thank you.
How can I live in both this world and the promised land? Shakes the ground beneath our feet and it changes us. And we go on, but not like we were before. Will you hold my hand in the ever-changing dark? Listen deep from within. Go forward and be blessed.
Thank you. Thank you very much. While we have a moment of transition, I'm going to introduce an alto member of the Harvard-Radcliffe Collegium Musicum, Madison Webb.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Madison Webb, and I'm a sophomore in Dunster House studying psychology. I'm proud to present one of the beneficiaries of our donations, the Black Arts Collective. The Black Arts Collective is a home for Black imaginaries and Black creatives to be in community with one another and discovery affinity through artistry. The soul of the space is truly that it is rooted in the healing nature of art, and especially art that is made in community, like we are doing in this concert today. All four of the founders and so many others on this campus are cognizant of the unique power of art historically in Black spaces as a nourishing, life-giving mode of therapy and suffering, as a way to process that pain when all other modes are stripped away. So, as the founders came to Harvard last year and saw so many talented Black artists creating in isolation, it made them yearn for a safe space where Black imagination could be nourished and cultivated through creation, appreciation, and public revelation and discussion of our art. Current members include myself and composer, vocalist, and bassist of this year's concert's new music initiative, Devon Gates. If you're interested in donating to the Black Arts Collective to further our mission, Please visit the QR codes posted in the transept during the intermission or after the concert. Thank you and enjoy the concert.
Hi everyone, I'm Xavier.
And I'm Beck. Tonight marks the in-person Harvard premiere of Don't Be Weary, Traveler, a six-part motet by our Nathaniel Dett and edited by Dr. Marcus Garrett. This piece has an interesting connection to Harvard. On a break from his position as professor of music at Hampton University, Dett was a special student at Harvard. Here he composed Don't Be Weary, Traveler in 1920 and won Harvard's Francis Boott Prize for choral composition, the same prize Eddie Raj won for Gray Skies this year. However, despite the accolades, Don't Be Weary, Traveler was never performed at Harvard to the best of our knowledge. Now it is quickly becoming a favorite collegium tune with its blend of Black spiritual symbolism and intricate polyphony.
Our process of learning and performing the work marks an intention to give voice to Don't Be Weary, Traveler at Harvard over 100 years after its publication. Not only does it remind us of the historical struggle for Black liberation, but it also remains relevant today as we continue to deconstruct the barriers that have traditionally kept Black voices out of these artistic spaces. Our performance, both sonically and symbolically, opens the gates to Harvard to honor Dett's enduring legacy at Harvard and in American choral music. It is a small act of repair that is long overdue.
Come along, traveler, come along, traveler, come along, traveler, come along, traveler. Take my yoke.
Over the last several years, the Harvard choruses have developed a meaningful relationship with an organization here in the Boston area that also has a network around the country called Education Through Music. And we'd like to welcome their executive director to share a little bit about their organization and work as we think about the work of repair and investment in our communities. Will you please welcome Mr. Daniel Mack from Education Through Music.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming this evening. As Andy mentioned, my name is Dan Mack. I'm the Executive Director of Education Through Music, Massachusetts. It is such a thrill to be here with you all tonight. We just have exciting, exciting plans for the fall that I'm so excited to share. We have done so much work over the past few years in our network schools in Boston. And prior to coming to this role, I was an instructional coach. And I've seen the transformation that it does and what it does for the children. And it's just, it's an unbelievable thing. This is the Long Long Foundation. If you're familiar with Mr. Long Long, he's a world-renowned classical pianist. His side gig, if he has any time, I don't know how he does it, but his organization is actually responsible for putting piano labs all over the world to the most neediest schools imaginable. I know because I was part of one right across the river in Boston Public Schools, and we installed one of these labs, and the transformation was unbelievable. And we are making plans this fall for Long Long and Education Through Music to come together, and we're actually going to be installing piano labs in Boston, New York, Denver, and Los Angeles. So it's very, very exciting, and I can't thank you all enough for being part of that, just being here this evening and doing everything that you're doing. And also, we have one more partner, which is unbelievable, the Boston Philharmonic. They were also partners with me in Boston Public Schools. They'll be a part of us in everything that we're doing this fall. So again, thank you so much. What an amazing night and what an amazing group of people to be involved with. Thank you so much.
Tonight, the Harvard-Radcliffe Collegium Musicum shares excerpts from Tesfa Wondemagegnehu's To Repair. We will relay moments of Tesfa's pilgrimage, which inspired the piece's creation, before Collegium shares the entire work in full. As you can see, illustrated on this map of the United States, Tesfa took a journey that spanned 60 days, visiting over 40 cities, seeking new friends along the way to learn what is needed to repair communities throughout our country. In this brief presentation, we hope to begin to tell the story of Tesfa's experience through both his words and our own.
Throughout his pilgrimage journey, as Tesfa drove around the country in his white Toyota Prius, he discovered common threads through myriad conversations which illuminated the path to repair. One of those threads was that in order to repair, we must be willing to tell the truth. If we cannot tell the truth about the ugly history embedded within the early days of our country, if we cannot speak truthfully about the brokenness of our society today, repair will always be out of reach.
Francis Scott Key, the father of the national anthem for the United States of America, also said, "Are you willing, gentlemen, to abandon your country, to permit it to be taken from you, and occupied by the abolitionist according to whose taste it is to associate and amalgamate with the Negro?" Tesfa says, "We could spend years revealing truth on some of America's most celebrated heroes, but many of us in this room already know that this country has done an extraordinary job of rewriting its history. The truth is that America's underbelly reveals a land of self-inflicted bloodshed, crime, and wrong."
Thank you. Tesfa's journey eventually brought him to the Equal Justice Initiative's National Memorial for Peace and Justice in Montgomery, Alabama. There, he recorded this video of an installation depicting an enslaved black family in chains and shackles. The woman's face is pained as she holds a baby with one arm and reaches forward toward the man, whose look of resignation embodies the millions who stared down centuries of terror and bondage.
There were so many who invested their lives into Tesfa's to help him become who he is today. I think we can all relate to that. Especially, it was music teachers who played what he calls a life-saving role. The second movement calls us all to consider how we invest in one another, and particularly in those who have been historically marginalized. There were many companions that accompanied Tesfa along his pilgrimage. Most poignantly, it was the companionship of song, and spirituals in particular, which were a source of strength and inspiration on the hardest days. One of those very difficult days was when Tesfa found himself outside the apartment of Corinne Gaines in Baltimore, where she was shot by the police and killed in front of her children. While sitting outside of the apartment, Tesfa sang the spiritual his mother taught him, "Sometimes I feel like a motherless child."
Brought Tesfa to Pulaski Road in Chicago, Illinois. Tesfa says, "I walked up and down Pulaski Road on the south side of Chicago so many times that I eventually grew numb to the noisiness of the road. After a while, it became white noise to me. It prompted me to ask this question, has America too become numb to the noisy, sorrowful cries of people suffering in this nation?" Laquan McDonald also walked down Pulaski Road. "When I was done with my walk, I got into my white Prius and continued the pilgrimage." His walk down Pulaski Road ended with him being shot 16 times by a Chicago police officer. So many people in this nation pray to God every day, asking God to allow their loved ones to come home safely from suffocating realities. Mothers pleading that Jesus would walk with their babies and protect them. Their prayers have only grown louder over the years. But when will all of us be willing to risk something of our own to make the madness end for our neighbors?
Shows Laquan walking southbound down the middle of Pulaski. There are squad cars visible in front of him and also squad cars behind him. The shooter's squad car is visible as it drives past Laquan. Two officers then exit that vehicle with their guns drawn. At that point, Laquan begins to look away from the officers at a southwest angle toward the sidewalk. When Laquan is about 12 to 15 feet away from the officers, the width of an entire lane of the southbound traffic, one officer begins shooting. Laquan immediately spins to the ground, and the video clearly shows that the officer continues to shoot Laquan multiple times as he lays in the street. 16 seconds pass from the time Laquan hits the ground until the last visible puff of smoke rises from his torso area. An officer then approaches Laquan, stands over him, and appears to shout something as he kicks the knife out of his hand.
Tesfa says, in the first video you watched at the EJI Museum, you probably noticed that it was shot in daylight. This was my second visit to the museum. The first visit was a special nighttime experience. It ended with me becoming physically ill as I waded through a sea of steel monuments, hanging from the ceiling with the names of black folk who have been lynched on the soil. About three-fourths of the way through, I couldn't take it anymore. I rushed towards the exit and encountered a black girl greeting people as they exited the museum. I asked her, how can you do this every day? Without missing a beat, she basically said, if my ancestors could do it, why can't I? I picked myself up, turned myself around, and finished the museum that night, and ended up being rewarded in the most unbelievable way. I came across a black woman and her black daughter standing in front of Elizabeth Alexander's poem, Invocation. I stood with them and joined in reading. A part of her poem reads, ancestors, you will still find us in cages, despised and disciplined. You will find us still misnamed. Here, you will find us despite. You will not find us extinct. You will find us here memoried and storied. You will find us here mighty. You will find us here divine. As Maya Angelou said, yet still, like air, we rise.
Empowers and leads us to renewal. Renewal that comes not in a quick and convenient way, but as we walk through the fire together. Unfortunately, the fire in our society is often stoked by actions which are intended to be cruel for cruelty's sake, while those in power grow in wealth and comfort. From the slave trade to Reconstruction, from Jim Crow to redlining and the war on drugs, from mass incarceration to police brutality, on and on it goes. Policies and systems which target our black, brown, and indigenous siblings. marginalizing efforts targeting the LGBTQ+ community, and so many more whose lives don't conform to these mainstreams. The fourth movement speaks directly to this cruelty and its resulting firestorm.
Stono Rebellion of 1739 was a slave uprising near the Stono River, southwest of Charleston, South Carolina. Nearly 40 years before the United States was established as a country, these enslaved Africans rose up to claim their liberty against their captors. While visiting the National Museum of African American History and Culture on the pilgrimage, Tesfa encountered a drum used in that uprising, which inspired the cries for liberty, or in the mother tongue, Lukongo. Empowered by a driving drum and a melodic motive from Kendrick Lamar's DNA.
Our journey through this work would not have been possible without the support and guidance of the University of Michigan Men's Glee Club, the ensemble that premiered the original tenor bass version of the work, and whose preparations informed and guided this presentation of theirs that we adapted for you this evening. We will begin our performance of To Repair after a moment of silent reflection and preparation, and inviting the composer to the stage. Thank you.
Said that nothing is more certainly I pray that we open our hearts, share all that we have, and spare us the length of the fire.
Thank you.
a whole bunch of black folk ended up missing because of evil. Evil isn't just spiteful words or morally bankrupt action. Evil is silence and indifference. Evil is apathy. The time is drawing. Judgment is near. Heed these words. We gotta open up, y'all. That's simple. I don't have to yell it. You just gotta open up. We gotta stop seeing strangers. We gotta stop seeing enemies. We gotta open our eyes. Truly only see kin. It's time for us to order our steps and walk humbly. Swallow our pride and recognize that the longer we take to make this happen, the longer this fire will burn. But there is hope. As we walk through this fire, hold on to your neighbor. Share all that you have and pour your divine light into all creatures, great and small. Reflect with me on these thoughts, on our need to adapt in order to survive. First, relinquishment. What do we need to let go of in order to not make matters worse? Second, restoration. What could we bring back to help us with the coming difficulties and tragedies? Third, resilience. What do we value? What do we want to keep? And how? And finally, reconciliation. With what and whom shall we make peace as we awaken to our mutual mortality? When we embrace our mutual mortality, our mutual brokenness, we discover our shared humanity. That's when the fire will end. I pray that it will be well with your soul, and love will reign on this earth for many years to come. May you find abundant grace, justice, mercy, peace.